Penguin Random House Audio presents Rogues Gallery, The Birth of Modern Policing and Organized Crime in Gilded Age New York by John Oller. Read for you by Steve Marvel. Prologue, Forming the Picture. The torso was found first, the headless upper part of the body of a well-built man bobbing in the East River on a hot summer day in New York City in 1897. Wrapped in floral-patterned red oilcloth, the type used to cover kitchen tables and line cupboards, the tightly tied package was pulled from the water by a group of boys playing near the pier at the foot of East 11th Street. The man's chest was sawed off just below the ribcage and was missing a sliced-out hunk of flesh. The following day, 10 miles away, a man and his two sons were out picking berries in the woods in a sparsely settled part of the Bronx near the High Bridge Aqueduct when they stumbled upon the lower part of the body, minus the legs. This bundle, too, was wrapped in red oilcloth. 3 days later, the severed leg showed up in another package near the Brooklyn Navy Yard, where sailors from the USS Vermont fished it from the river. All that was missing now was the head. Among the first New York police detectives assigned to the case was 31-year-old Arthur Carey, a boyish-faced, Staten Island-born son of an Irish cop. A veteran of the Central Detective Bureau in Lower Manhattan, Carey specialized in homicide cases. But lately, he had been patrolling the beat in Goatville, the Bronx precinct where the lower torso had been discovered in the woods. Like Russians banished to Siberia, police officers who fell out of favor during one of the department's periodic political shakeups were reassigned to Goatville, where nothing much ever happened. That had been Carey's fate in 1895 after his mentor, Police Chief Thomas F. Byrnes, the most famous cop in America, was forced into retirement by Theodore Roosevelt, the new head of the Board of Police Commissioners. The reformer Roosevelt had taken office in the wake of a highly publicized legislative investigation that unearthed rampant police corruption in New York City. Although Carey was not personally implicated in the scandal, the fallout was enough to get him sent to Goatville, where he'd been languishing for almost 2 years. Carey's career would change dramatically beginning on June 27, 1897, when the package containing the limbless midsection was brought into the Bronx precinct station. Carey and his partner unwrapped the bundle to find, in addition to layers of brown paper and burlap, red and gold-patterned oilcloth that matched the type enclosing the partial corpse found in the East River the day before. The two pieces of wrapping even fit together. Carey now dismissed the initial police theory that mischievous medical students had cut up a cadaver and dumped it in the river to create a mystery. Instead, the matching oilcloth suggested a carefully coordinated crime by the same hand. He also noted, as confirmed later by city morgue doctors who fit the body parts together like a jigsaw puzzle, that the body appeared to have been crudely hacked with a saw, not a precision medical knife. Carey was sure this was no joke. Despite his exile to Goatville, murder followed me here, Carey would later recall. As he continued examining the body, Carey spotted something else. A small ink stamp on a piece of wet brown wrapping paper stuck to the man's back, which read, Kugler and Wallen's Hardware, 277 Bowery. Carey guessed that the saw had been purchased there. So he took the Third Avenue elevated train down to the corner of Bowery and Houston, near the central headquarters station at 300 Mulberry Street, where he had begun his detective career under Byrnes. The Bowery was the seediest part of town, filled with concert saloons, brothels, dime museums, gambling dens, vaudeville houses, shooting galleries, and pawn shops. Low-rise tenements and flophouses also lined the muddy, garbage-strewn streets where a melange of impoverished immigrants dwelt. Germans and Irish who had arrived in droves in earlier decades, as well as Chinese and, increasingly, Italians and Jews. Packs of neglected and homeless children, many of them once and future pickpockets and thieves, ran wild through the streets. They shared the crowded spaces with drunks who lay along the curb and doorways next to empty beer kegs. At 295 Bowery, just across the street from Kugler and Wollin's, was the most sordid dive in New York. McGurk's Saloon, a combination dance hall and whorehouse frequented by thieves and lowlives. 2 years later, McGurk's would become known as Suicide Hall after a series of prostitutes jumped from the saloon's fifth-floor windows or imbibed carbolic acid to end their lives. The waiters at McGurk's drugged patrons to steal from them, and the bouncer, an ex-prize fighter nicknamed Eat 'em Up, Jack McManus, was considered the toughest brawler in New York. He got his nickname when, after confronting someone whose conduct he disapproved of, he criticized the offender with his teeth. His knife-scarred face gave him a caveman look, made worse by a missing ear, chewed off in a fight. At the hardware store, Carrie found sheets of brown paper used for packaging, the same as the kind that covered the torso. He then tracked down a Bowery neighborhood fabric supplier who recognized the manufacturer of the red oilcloth pattern, A.F. Buchanan and Sons, pattern number Diamond B3220. It had been distributed to 50-some stores in the city, each of which now had to be canvassed. Assisted by tabloid newspaper reporters who were eagerly pursuing the same leads, Carrie soon ascertained that a stout German midwife named Augusta Knack had bought the oilcloth from a dry goods shop in the Long Island City neighborhood of Queens a few days before the body parts had started showing up. Mrs. Knack, estranged from her husband, lived in a Hell's Kitchen boarding house at 34th Street and 9th Avenue, and occasionally sublet part of her flat to others. One of her roomers, a German immigrant named William Goldensuppe, had been missing from his job as a Turkish bath masseur since the day before the murder. Co-workers confirmed he had a tattoo of a girl in the spot carved out of the victim's chest, and they identified the reassembled body at the morgue as that of Goldensuppe. It turned out that Goldensuppe had been Augusta Knack's lover until she jilted him in favor of a former roomer, a barber named Martin Thorne. The rivals had tangled on several occasions. Goldensuppe had twice beaten Thorne senseless, after which the barber moved out. It appeared that Thorne had a motive for revenge. "The police machine began to grind," Carrie recalled later. The keeper of a duck farm in Woodside, Queens, not far from the Long Island City shop where the oilcloth was purchased, reported that, for some days, the water in his duck pond had taken on a peculiar reddish substance that had made his ducks sick. Detectives traced the blood to a sewer line connected to a bathtub in a vacant cottage nearby. Neighbors confirmed that a heavy-set woman, accompanied by a man in a dark suit and brown derby, had recently rented the place under the names of Mr. and Mrs. Braun. They were later identified as Augusta Knack and Martin Thorne. The two were duly arrested, and Knack eventually made a full confession. Knack had lured Goldensuppe to the vacant rental, where Thorne sprang from hiding to shoot him. The couple proceeded to dismember him in the bathtub, after which they disposed of the body parts. Only the head, encased in plaster of Paris, had managed to stay submerged after being tossed in the river. Knack received a 12-year prison sentence, while her lover, Thorne, was convicted at trial and given the electric chair in Sing Sing, the state prison on the Hudson River in Ossining, New York. In his memoirs, Carey wrote that the case of the scattered Dutchman had taught him certain fundamentals. First, that in a murder case, there is no one obvious clue, but that all clues are good if they are direct. And second, that the police detective machine, though small at the time, functioned with precision and relentlessly from patrolmen on the beat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.